Start with Boundless Love.
God's house today, and everybody see it. Now, take a seat and let's go to the Lord in prayer. God, thank you so much for your many blessings, and we just give you praise and glory. We commit this time of worship and celebration to your sweet and holy name. And if anyone doesn't know you as Savior, would today be the day they come to that perfect joy and knowledge of the free pardon of sin. Thy will be done in all things, and it's in Jesus' name we've prayed. Amen. Sing along with us.
Well, good morning, Notchy Creek. The Lord said, where we're gathered together, he will be there in the midst. So I've got a little chorus I want us to sing this morning. You may or may not know it, but just sing along.
His feet, hallelujah, his fear, amen, is here, holy, holy, I will bless his name again, his fear.
Sing it one more time. Stand together, please, as we sing. He lives, he lives. Christ Jesus lives today.
I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy. I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's all.
Now welcome those around you. Tell them how glad you are to be in the Lord's house this morning.
All right.
receive the morning tithes and offerings, would you join me in a word of prayer as the ushers come? Father, we give you praise and glory for your precious Son, Jesus Christ. And Lord, we just thank you for your many blessings. And Lord, we pray you'd watch over this time now as we continue in worship through the giving and receiving of tithes and offerings. Lord, we pray you'd touch it, anoint it as only you can, and may it be used for the furtherance of thy kingdom. Thy will be done in all things. In Jesus' name we've prayed. Amen. Brandon and Hannah singing for us today. Would you make them welcome as they come?
How wide Lord, I'm amazed by you. Lord, I'm amazed by you and how you love me.
What a blessing. Be finding the book of Daniel, chapter number 1. We look today about life's about choices. You made a choice to be here today, and we're grateful for that. And I know God will honor that and bless you in return. Now, we also may make hundreds of choices today, or thousands of choices. It may be as simple as moving your foot from one pedal to the other, from the gas pedal to the brake, or not in some cases, but guess what? Life's about choices. And when it comes to your decision with Jesus Christ, you need to know that no choice is a choice. And we need to be aware of that. In Daniel chapter number 1, we see a lesson that I believe God would have us to learn today and look at in His holy word. Would you stand in reverence for the reading of God's word, those that are able? Daniel chapter number 1, beginning in verse number 1. Here's what the Bible says. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, came Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, into Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, with part of the vessels of the house of God, which he carried into the land of Shinar to the house of his God, and he brought the vessels into the treasure house of his God. And the king spake unto Ashpenaz, the master of his eunuchs, that he should bring certain of the children of Israel, and of the king's seed, and of the princes, children in whom was no blemish, but well favored, and skillful in all wisdom, and cunning in knowledge, and understanding science, and such as had ability in them to stand in the king's palace, and whom they might teach the learning and the tongue of the Chaldeans. And the king appointed them a daily provision of the king's meat and of the wine which he drank, so nourishing them 3 years, that at the end thereof they might stand before the king. Now among these were of the children of Judah, Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, to whom the prince of the eunuchs gave names, for he gave unto Daniel the name of Belshazzar, and unto Hananiah of Shadrach, and to Mishael of Meshach, and to Azariah of Abednego. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with a portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. That's a reading from God's holy word, and everybody say it.
Amen.
God, we come to you now and just say, thy will be done. Move me to the side and you preach to these dear people today. And Lord, I pray that they would hear not from me, but from you. I have nothing worth hearing to say, but you have a message from your word of God, and we all need that. So we pray thy will be done in every heart, every life, and every home. In Jesus' name we've prayed. Amen. Thank you, and be seated. We see there are lots of choices to be made. When we look just in God's holy word in the Bible, there's choices that we see. Just a few of them would include: Abel chose to bring honorable sacrifice to God. Moses chose to identify himself with Israel. Joshua chose for his house to serve the Lord. Noah chose to build an ark. David chose following the Lord rather than remaining a shepherd boy out in the field. Abraham chose obedience over his own son's life as he prepared to sacrifice Isaac before God intervened. Ruth chose not to return to her land, but to stay right where she was so she'd be usable by God. Nehemiah chose to rebuild a city once he heard of the desolation of Jerusalem. The disciples chose to leave their nets and became fishers of men. Joseph chose the things of God and ended up saving his household because of that. Rahab chose to hide the spies. Just a few choices we see in God's holy word. Now, in verse number 1 of Daniel chapter number 1, we see some things as a background. We see that the city has been overtaken. We see that King Nebuchadnezzar has besieged the city. And we need to catch that, because now we're living in a different day. It has changed. Jerusalem is overtaken by Nebuchadnezzar. And we need to see in verse number 3 then what has happened there as well. The king spake unto Ashpenaz, the master's eunuch, that he should bring certain of the children of Israel, the king's seed, and his princes. You see, we see there's a plan of the king. Now, we need to know this in our mind today. Now, hear me clearly. The devil has a plan. Just like if the king in this verse 3 had a plan for not only these young people, you need to know the world has a plan, and there's traps set everywhere for old and young alike. The devil has a plan as well. If that makes sense, say amen. See, the purpose of what the devil's plan is here in Daniel chapter 1 is to take something, God's children, and to make something that God made good and turn it into something bad or for the wrong usage. That's true in the Garden of Eden. It was very good, but then when the fall of man came, then sin entered and death and disease and all those things that we are still dealing with today. But one day that curse is going away. Praise be to God. Now, in verse number 3, we see that there's a plan. In verse number 4, we see that there's also something else, another purpose. He is going to, look at that, might teach the learning of the tongue of the Chaldeans. Now listen to me very carefully. There was a plan to get the youth off course in this day and age, and there is a plan in our world today to do the same thing. And listen, I'm from the country. We would call this brainwashing. The word you hear today is called indoctrination. Your children are being saturated and indoctrinated to believe that alternate lifestyles are beautiful and wonderful and the thing that everybody ought to do. They are being told lies from the pit of hell about all sorts of different social issues. Listen, we need to get in the book, go by the book, live by the book, and die by the book. Amen. Now, when we think about that, there is a plan of this world to get our children. It started years ago. The devil's a little patient, although he knows his time is limited. He's patient. We're going to kick prayer out of school. We have God basically out of school. We have God out of Congress. We have God. That was a good place for an amen. We have God out of all of our major institutions of government. Now listen, somebody once said that you don't need to talk about politics from the pulpit. Listen to me very carefully. There is a great beast coming, and that known as Antichrist. And the Antichrist is going to control the religion, he's going to want to control the government, and he's going to want to control the economics. And I can put that in Revelation. This was all unplanned. This was not even in the first service this morning. But hear me, we must know there's a plan out there, and God's not just trying to get you when you're adult, young people. He's trying to get you now. God's trying to get you to come to him. And the devil's trying to yank you down and stay off course. Do you know what's off course? Anything other than God's plan. Now, when we look in verse number 5 right there, the king made it appealing. Oh, and isn't that what happens in our world? It sounds appealing. We'll woo you. He said, I'm going to give them a portion of my meat. I promise you the king's eating better than the peasants. He said, I'm going to give them some of my food, and I'm going to give them some of my drink, and made it sound oh so appealing. And when we look in our world today, guess what? Isn't that what the world does? It makes it boring. I mean, listen, we have commercials on TV that want you to go places. We try to, do those kind of things in vacation, but yet we're allured by lights and glamour and glitter and all that kind of stuff. When's the last time your kid said, hey, listen, can we go to the Moody Bible Institute this summer for vacation? I've yet to see a commercial for that. But you're being enticed to go to Disney World. You're being enticed to go to all these other places. Now listen, I'm not saying there's anything inherently evil about where you go on vacation. I'm just saying the devil wants to allure you and pull you to things, so he makes it very appealing. The king made it appealing. Get those boys and feed them something right there. Now again, we see immediately how the world wants to change you and that you change your name. In verse number 6, the Bible says, and 7, it says, and to whom the prince of the eunuchs gave names. So Daniel became Belteshazzar, and we see that Hananiah, Shadrach, Mishael, Meshach, and then we know Azariah, Abednego. And when we look right there, all of those things are changes. But the key verse today is verse number 8. The key verse is when one person purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with a portion of the king's meat. Have you made such a commitment? Have you made such a commitment that I refuse to defile myself with what this world has to offer? Now listen, you have to have an eternal and a biblical perspective in order to do that, because what does the world say? Go for the gusto. Live for today. Get all you can. Hurt anybody in your path. It's all about you. And that's not what God's word teaches. If that makes sense, say amen. Amen. The word purpose literally means right there in the original language to be set, to commit, or to be determined. Daniel was set. He was committed. He was determined. Now, if you go on in the word defile, literally means to pollute, to desecrate, to stain, or to soil. Now, let's put that in perspective. Daniel, determined, committed, set forth in his heart that he would not desecrate himself. Listen, if you get offended when somebody desecrates a statue or something in society, why aren't we as offended when we choose to desecrate our bodies? Why are we not offended when we choose to soil our minds? Why are we not as worried when we choose to stain? Now listen, there's forgiveness, and we'll get to that in a moment. If you are here today in need of forgiveness, God is a forgiving God, and everybody see it. And God covers a sin with the blood of the Lamb. But just like if your grandchild or child came to your house this afternoon for lunch and carried that bright red Kool-Aid that you made for them because they love it into your living room with that brand new carpet that you have and they spilled it, guess what? You may forgive them eventually, but there may be a stain. Forgiveness, yes, but your life may be altered by the choices you make. There's a stain. So when we look in God's Word today, have you made this commitment? And if you've not made this commitment, I want to challenge everybody to make such a commitment. First of all, let's start with, what is a defilement? Now, first, let me just say this. Daniel said, I'm not going to defile myself. Do you know what may defile you? If you don't know what may defile you, then you're going to have a hard time keeping such a commitment. You could be defiled before you even realize it. What defiles? Let me give you two things. Here they are. One, if it's contrary to the Word of God, it's going to defile you. And everybody say it. That's clear. That's why we want to sit under biblical preaching, biblical teaching. We want to be in God's Word on our own. We want to know what God says about these things. And even if God didn't specifically address in, you know, a sentence that said, thou shalt not, the Holy Spirit, through the working of the Word in you, can give you discernment to know if that's something you need to be part of or not. It's called conviction, and it's called the working of the Holy Spirit in your life. If that makes sense, say amen. Number two is contrary to your good will. See, there's things that aren't good for us, but that doesn't necessarily mean God doesn't put them in the Bible and say, thou shalt not. Now, this is not a spiritual example, but let me give you an example. We had not been married very long. All right, good. She's in the first service. I can tell this. We had not been married very long, and guess what? I was ready before she was. I blew the horn. I don't even buy a car with a horn on it anymore. I blew the horn, Jeff, twice that day, my first time and my last. You see, nowhere in God's Word does it say, don't blow the horn for your wife to come outside. Now, when we post this online, if we could edit this part out in case she watches, amen. Nowhere in the Bible does it say, don't blow the horn for your wife to come outside. But it wasn't in my best interest. And there's things in our spiritual lives that are not in our best interest, but it may not specifically say, don't do it. But know this as a rule. When God, either in direct command or by discernment, tells you not to do something, it's not because he doesn't want you to have fun or enjoy yourself. What he's really saying is, that's not good for you, and therefore I'm protecting you from it. And when he says, yeah, pursue that, I got no beefs with that, he's saying, I love you, go help yourself, because he loves you. I believe that's an Adrianism, actually. But guess what? When we look in God's Word, that's what we see at play here. So, by the way, there's all sorts of, we're at different places in life. Don't look around and don't point, but we have 6, 7, 8 different generations or 9 decades maybe represented in the room. The single adult is facing maybe a possible more threatening defilement today than the student. Young students, you'll have to decide, though, what you're going to allow. See, you got a purpose in your heart before you get there. Students, if you are invited to parties, and parents, you need to know what's going on and who's there. And by the way, trust no one. Yes, I mean that, because the devil's trying to get you babies. Hear me clearly. Young people, you may be having to decide this. Are you going to purpose in your heart, I'm not going to drink? Young person, are you going to purpose in your heart, I'm not going to be sexually active? Young person, are you going to say, I'm not going to do drugs? See, everybody's got a line in the sand somewhere. What is your line in the sand? See, the students are facing some of those kind of things, and students of any age, for that matter, even on into college and that stuff. You go to a party, are you purposed in your heart before you get there, I'm not going to drink? Let me encourage you, if you know drinking's going to be there, don't go to the party. I don't like fighting the devil I like to play home games. I want to fight on my territory, not on his. But you see that. You got a young man in your life or a young lady in your life, student, you're dating them, and parents, listen to me. Sexual intercourse and intimacy is just a game that kids are playing these days, much like you used to play cards or something like that. It's just a way to have fun. I could tell you horror stories that make me blush and you pass out of things I've dealt with in school in the last few years. Now, you still with me? Say amen. Amen. Young people, what is your line in the sand? Don't let the devil say, well, we're going to get married eventually, so that's okay. Not according to the book. But is it purposed in your heart? Even Billy Graham used to tell that he put the Bible between him and Ruth when they were courting. Now, if you don't know what courting is, ask Larry. He can tell you. Now, listen, when they were courting, guess what? That way, it reminded them, I'm going to have to go over God's word to do something I don't need to do. Married adults, are you here, right here, right now, this many people in 2024? Do you lust after another person outside of your marriage? Do you have a pornography problem? Does the remote control take on new meaning after everybody else goes to bed at night? Does your phone have things on it that if everybody could see it would embarrass you? Have you purposed in your heart, I'm not going to defile myself? The senior adult here issues clearly different than the teenager. The senior adult, you may be fighting defilement by simply doing this, sitting and soaking. Sitting and soaking. If you just decide, I'm just going to come and sit, atrophy and not be involved in God's word, and I'm not going to respond to God's word, and I'm just going to live out my days till I die, and I'm not doing anything for the Lord, see, that may defile you as well, because we're called to do things while we're here. See, there's all kinds of defilements. Let me give you some. If I could, I want to give you just a short list. Here, you're still with me, say amen. I want to give you a short list. Go to Proverbs chapter number 6. In Proverbs chapter number 6, we're going to look at some things there that I know defile you because God hates them. Now, this is not everything that defiles you, but I believe the Holy Spirit can let you know what your issues are. And you know what your greatest temptations are. You know, I'll be honest with you, you could back up a Coors Light truck to my house and say free for the rest of your life. That is not my weakness. That is not appealing to me. No temptation there at all. But I've got my weaknesses too. And that's what the devil will try to tempt me with. If that makes sense, say amen. Amen. See, it may be a little different. These, though, are seven things that I know are defilements because God hates them. And the seventh one is an abomination. Now, let's go through that. Look in Proverbs 6 and verse 16 to start with. In verse 16, it says, these six things doth the Lord hate. Everybody say hate. One, two, three. Hate. Hates them. And if God hates them, I'm pretty sure that we're not going to be doing them and saying, but God's okay with me doing them. Verse 17, a proud look. We're going to rapid fire here. A proud look deals with elevated thought of yourself. Hey, don't feel like, there's been some preachers that even told stories like this. Preachers can get proud too. Everybody coming up, patting them on the back, getting all those letters they get each week, telling them what a good job they're doing. Everybody bragging on them. Everybody, I don't know where that is. But anyways, but guess what? Some preachers can get filled with themselves and have an elevated thought. One old boy said that he was confident when he heard one preacher. He strutted when he was way to the pulpit. When he got through preaching, he signed his own Bible. An elevated thought. Now, let me give you a leadership principle here, okay? You still with me? Say amen. Don't have an elevated thought of yourself. Some of you are very smart. All of you are smarter than me. Don't say amen. I got it. All right. All of you are smarter than me. Some of you are very smart, but that doesn't mean you're always right. That doesn't mean that we need to always do it your way. Some people get so proud that even when it's not in their lane of traffic, they're an expert. Here's what'll help this church. Boy, Brother Doug preached a great message yesterday morning at the men's prayer breakfast and challenged us all to be men and stand up and be the people God would have us to be, but also to be on lookout as we go through these growing pains and those kind of things, because the devil will try to get in the mix of that. And we need to stay in our own lane. Let me give you a real simple example. How do you get seven? Well, John may say 6 plus 1. Larry may say 3 times 2 plus 1. Somebody else may say 4 plus 3. You see, we all came up with 7, but we got there a different way. And just because we go through growing pains and we get the, even as we enter this next phase of what we're going to do to replace square footage and all that kind of stuff, don't think everything has to be your way. That's a proud look, because you think your way is the best way in all things. Now, even preachers, I shared this many months ago now, probably more than once, but even preachers can get down that road too. The old boy sat back in his chair on Monday morning and kicked back and told his wife, said, "Oh, honey, you know there's just not that many good preachers out there anymore." And she said, "I know, honey, and there's one less than you think there is." Number two, a lying tongue. Now listen, that is not a tongue that sits still. Don't think, "Oh, I need to talk a lot because God hates a lying tongue." It doesn't mean it being still in your mouth. It means it fraudulent. The word literally there renders out deceptive and fraudulent. And we need to understand, do people know they can count on you to tell the truth? Do you know I've had people in this room, in this sanctuary since I've been here, look me dead in the eye, not knowing somebody else had told me something or something, the event had happened, and bold-faced lie to me in this sanctuary. You know how much credibility you have in them and how much confidence I have in their spiritual walk the rest of the way? Not a whole lot. See, God hates a lying tongue. We need to understand a proud look is offensive to God, a lying tongue. And if we have a proud look or we have a lying tongue, then that defiles us. And we need to purpose in our heart, we're going to get rid of that. If that makes sense, say amen. It says hands that shed innocent blood, literally renders out. It's the killing for a reason apart from someone that's committed a capital crime. And listen, don't be offended. And that shocks people in 2024 because we're so cultured. We should never be so cultured that we outgrow the Bible. And God implemented the death penalty in the book of Genesis. Wow. Wish he hadn't said that. Well, that's okay. I got more things to cheer you up here in a minute. But listen, when I have hands that shed innocent blood, it just reveals, you know who I'm acting like? My daddy, the devil. In John chapter 8 and verse 44, the Bible teaches us those things when it says, "You are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father you will do." He was a murderer from the beginning. He didn't just commit an act of a random act of violence to be a murderer. He was a murderer from the beginning, and he's still on a murdering rampage today. He wants to destroy you. He wants to destroy your family. He wants to destroy this church. He wants to destroy Christianity, but I got good news. I've read this book. God wins in the end. And when we look in verse number 17, that ends, that hands that shed innocent blood, we're reminded in John 10:10, it also says those three words that we're reminded. He came to steal and to what? Kill. Everybody, and to what? Kill and to destroy. We need to remind ourselves, if we have hands that shed innocent blood, we are a murderer. And we need to be aware of that. Look in verse number 18 of Proverbs 6, a heart that devises wickedness. You know, that's premeditated. You know, that's not a random act. You've devised a plan. That means you sat down and you've schemed and you've worked on that. That'll defile you and your walk, your testimony. It'll defile a church. It'll defile a family when you have a scheme always to do the devil's work. You know why? You have to be familiar with the devil in order to do his work. When we look in verse 18, it says, feet that be swift to run in running to mischief. And there are people that seem like they just run, wherever mischief is. Have you ever noticed that sometimes people go to this church and then that church and then that church and then that church, and every time they got to that church had a problem. A man left church mad at me one time. I still can see him peeling out of the parking lot, throwing rocks all up on the lawn as he was mad. And I got a call that night from another pastor in the community. And he said, "Shane, I just want you to know every preacher in this county is mad at you." I thought, gracious, what a day this has been. I said, "Why is every preacher in the county mad at me?" He said, "Because we're all afraid that he's going to show up at our place next week." A heart that deviseth wicked imaginations and feet that are swift in running to mischief. Now look in verse number 19, and I want us to just sit there for just a minute. He says a false witness. Now, when you've read that over the years, many of you might have thought he's talking about somebody that testifies against somebody. And that's really not what it's implying. You know what it's talking about, a false witness? That you have a fake walk with Christ in a New Testament sense. You are giving us one image on Sunday and another image in the real world the rest of the week. He hates a false witness. We need to be true. We need to practice what we preach. We need to live out what we say. We need to be the same at church as we are out of church. And as was mentioned by me a couple of weeks ago, and Doug reinforced it actually yesterday morning, we don't even come to church to worship. We bring our worship to church because we should be worshiping the Lord all week long. He says, I hate a false witness that speaketh lies. Now, when you tie that in, you see, I am lying to you if I get up and I am not what I am the rest of the week today. I am misleading you and you are misleading others. So it does talk about the testimony of truth and the power of that, but it's also talking about a fake walk. Is your walk with Christ real, or is it actions that we see on Sunday and we assume that's what it's like the rest of the week, but what you really are the rest of the week is very different than what you are on Sunday? God says, I hate that. And then at the end of verse 19, he said, not only do I hate these six things, this last one's an abomination. Now, isn't it funny that we cling to that word abomination? Oh, we take it real serious when it talks about things like the homosexual lifestyle, which is an abomination to God, and those things. But yet some of the very people that cry out the loudest about other abominations in God's word are the very ones that can keep a church torn up all the time. They sow discord among the brethren. Now listen, see, I'm got to choose. I've either got to sow good seed or I sow discord. But the Bible says that God hates this. He that soweth discord, that is going to be a defilement if you're a discord sower. You know, there's people that come to every church. Listen, we're not in West Tennessee. We're not in Alabama. We're in spiritual warfare right here. And as God tries to do something with us, if you find somebody else trying to sow discord, hang up. Tell them to shut up, because we want to go up with the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, preacher, that's kind of odd. That's kind of bashful. I'm married to him. Well, pray for him. There will be people that sow discord. You know what church they really sow discord in? All of them where Jesus is really trying to get glorified. Now, look with me in the word right here. It says, he that soweth discord among the brethren. And you know how he does that? By any means possible. Everybody say any. One, two, three. Any. That means he may be a talebearer. It may be that he may try to provoke jealousy. Nothing provokes jealousy more in a church than church growth, because if you've got 400 people instead of 200 people, guess what? Of the new 200 people, they may have some talents and skills that we want to get plugged in, whether it's teaching or musician or preaching or whatever it may be. They may have financial knowledge and we want to get them plugged in on different groups and that kind of stuff. Guess what? Where they can help with different issues, or they may have expertise in a certain field. All of those kind of things, but it threatens the people that currently have spots. He that soweth discord by any means possible. The sower of discord lives. By the way, do you know that there are drama kings and queens in churches? I don't know. Young people, do you know there's some in your school? And usually when you follow a drama prince home, there's a drama king waiting on him at the house. And when you follow the drama princess home from school, they'll keep locker rooms stirred up, they'll keep classrooms stirred up, and they'll keep churches stirred up. You see, they're just filled with drama. And they sow discord by making each other jealous. They carry tales. God loves concord, and he hates discord. If that makes sense, say amen. So when we look in this, we need to understand that the goal of a sower of discord is to end neighborly and brotherly love. Now, if I'd have started out today and said, all right, listen, how many of us want to end brotherly love? I hope nobody would have raised a hand. God loves concord. If that makes sense, say amen. Amen. Now go back to Daniel chapter 1. These are seven things, real quick, those seven things that at least defile. Now, there's other things that defile. We know all the different sins that mention in the Bible. In addition, there's some things that I think are sins of mine that may not be sins if you do them. In other words, if God tells me to do or not to do something and I do it, I've sinned. But he may not tell you to do or not to do that one thing. If that makes sense, amen. Have you made a purpose in your heart yet? Now look in Daniel chapter number 1. Look in Daniel chapter number 1 and verse number 8, the last part of verse number 8. What does it say? It says that he requested of the prince of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. Daniel spoke up. And sometimes to not defile yourself at school, at work, at church, in the community, you got to speak up. You got to be able to say, I'm not a drinker. You got to be able to speak up and say, I appreciate you asking me out on that date, but if us being sexually intimate is on your agenda, then we don't need to go on a date. You need to be able to say, I have already purposed in my heart that I'm not going to be a sower of discord at Notchy. I have purposed in my heart that I ain't going to kill anybody at Notchy. That'd be good too. I've said that one. You got a purpose in your heart that you're not going to run to mischief. You're not going to be a distraction to God's work. Have you purposed those things in your heart? Because what he did is he went to then the prince of the eunuchs and said, hey, I need some help. I'm in a bind. The king may have brought me up and you've got me here and I'm supposed to eat at the king's table. But Daniel realized something that we need to realize. There's nothing at the devil's table that's good for us. And he said, hey, I got an idea. The guy said, man, I can't do it. He's told me I got to feed you all this stuff. And if I don't feed you this stuff, guess what? If I don't feed you this stuff, then I'm going to be in trouble. And Daniel said, hey, let's do a little test. Look with me, if you will, in verse number 12. In verse number 12, he said, prove thy servants 10 days and let them give us pulse to eat and water to drink. For years, we've kind of rendered out pulse as being vegetables, but it also renders out of a wheat background. And as J. Vernon McGee said sometimes, Daniel said, listen here, big boy, you feed them a king's meat and wine and give us our spiritual Wheaties and we're going to go somewhere with God. And they did that test for 10 days. Verse 15, we see, and at the end of the 10 days, their countenance appeared fairer and fatter in flesh than all the children which ate at the king's table. You know why? Because they were eating at God's table. And what's at God's table is better for you than what's at the king's table. If that makes sense, amen. Now, when we look right there, we see in verse 18 then something. At the end of the days, now the 3 years is up, that the king had said he should bring them in. Then the prince of the eunuchs brought them in before Nebuchadnezzar. And the king communed with them, verse 19. And among them all found none. There all was found none. None like these old boys. You know why? Because they had not defiled themselves. Now listen to me. Maybe you're here today, though, and have. And I got good news. You have an advocate with the Father. Through Jesus the Son, He is faithful and just to forgive you of sins. I think there's probably four groups of people in the room today. There's groups of people that have said, I have purpose in my heart. I'm not going to defile myself. And you're trying your best to live and do that every day. There's others that said at some point in time, I've purposed in my heart, I'm not going to defile myself, but you're sitting here right now knowing that you've got sin in the camp. There's third group that ain't even made this promise yet because it'd cost you more than you're willing to pay, give you up something that you like. It may cost you a friendship. It may cost you to have to move seats at church even. It may cost you something, but you've not made that commitment. And fourthly, there's the lost man that doesn't know how to make that commitment because you're not going to commit to something that's foreign to you because you're still the natural man, not the spiritual man or the carnal man. If that makes sense, amen. Verse number 19 said there's none like them. Now, let me just say this and then we're done. That's the first and we're done. Even if Nebuchadnezzar hadn't noticed they were different, they were different on the inside. And they were still better off because they had been obedient to God. They were still better off because they had been obedient to God. They were still better off. So even if the world doesn't take note of how much God's doing, even if the world still doesn't take note that you look different than the rest of the world, we're still called to live a separated life and we'll be healthier and better. Where are you in those four groups today? Like we started with earlier and all that list of people it chose, you have to choose. God's given you free choice. You can come to Christ or you can reject Christ. You can purpose in your heart, which means to determine, to commit, or you can just live by it. Listen, Adrian Rogers said it. One big choice now will keep you from having to make a bunch of little choices every day. One choice now of following the Lord and being true to His word will help you to know what to do in all the little decisions. Now listen, God calls us back to Him. If that makes sense, amen. Are you here today? Are you that person that has made a commitment and you're doing your best to stick to it?
That may be a need for prayer today, for strength. Maybe you've purposed in your heart and you're not going to defile yourself, but you're not even sure what defiles you, but you know you got some things messed up. That's a prayer request. Maybe you're here today, and guess what? You're not sure what all the defilements are, but you need to get in God's Word, and the Holy Spirit will reveal that to you in your life so that when something pops up, God, the Holy Spirit, can say, oh, you don't need that. That's not good for you. Run. Sometimes that's a person that pops up, and God needs to tell us to run from them. Sometimes it's an event. You still with me? Say amen. Maybe you're here today and say, you know, I've never made a commitment. I got saved years ago, but I've never purposed in my heart. Oh, what would you do if you're faced with situations and you've not already purposed in your heart? Then you're subject to peer pressure. Then you're subject to all of these voices in your head. Then you're subject to just go with the crowd. And then you're subject to end up a place that you never dreamed you'd end up because one decision you weren't prepared to make because you hadn't already purposed in your heart. Maybe today's the day that you need to say, God, you saved me years ago, a week ago, decades ago, whatever, but I am committing today to purpose in my heart to not defile myself with this old world. Maybe you're here and don't know Christ as Savior. Would today be the day that you'd come and say, I need to be saved and I need to live for the Lord because I want heaven to be my home and Jesus to be my master. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Nobody's looking around. Life's about choices. Musician and song leader coming for hymn of response. Life's about choices. And I'm just curious where you are in the scheme of things. I can't help but believe in a crowd this size in 2024 that everybody here, praise God if it's true, but I can't help but believe that not everybody here can say, I have purposed in my heart. I have thought through things that are absolutely the line of my, in the sand of my life, and I'm not going to do that. What if that fiance of yours or that boyfriend or girlfriend, and you find out something, where's the line that you're willing to say? What if they don't think it's important to go to church? What if they don't think raising children in fear and admonition of the Lord? What line is in the sand of your life that you're saying, I've purposed in my heart, I'm not going past that line? Maybe you're here today and glory to God, you've purposed in your heart to not defile yourself. You've done that earlier, but you just want to pray for strength to live for the Lord. Maybe you're here and you've purposed in your heart, but things are amiss. You want to make sure that God has identified defilements and you want to run from them for the glory of God. Maybe you're here and have never made a commitment to say, I'm going to not defile myself, and you need to make that today. Maybe you're here and just need Jesus. Quietly as you can, would you stand to your feet? Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Nobody's looking around. This altar is open for you to be obedient to the voice of God, whatever that may be. Father, thank you for your many blessings. And Lord, we just pray thy will be done in this time of response. May men and women respond to your voice and not mine. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You be obedient as we sing together. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Nobody's looking around for just a moment. I'm not going to beg you. I'm not going to berate you. If God's spoken to your heart, I just implore you to respond obediently. God shared something with your heart today, and you've dealt with that right there, or just desire continued prayer, would you just say, preacher, would you pray for me this week? Would you slip your hand up in the air? God bless you. Amen. God bless you, ladies and gentlemen. God bless you. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, Lord. God bless you. Touch them. Yes, sir.